What is a chronic aortic dissection? Aortic dissection is considered chronic 90 days after onset of symptoms and subacute between 15 to 90 days after the event. Chronic aortic dissection can either be uncomplicated with a stable disease course or complicated by progressive aneurysmal degeneration, chronic visceral or limb malperfusion, and persisting or recurrent pain or even rupture. Patients with chronic aortic dissection also include those previously operated for type A aortic dissection, sending aorta surgery, with persisting dissection of the descending aorta. Long-term evolution of type A aortic dissection is treated surgically, and type B and type B medically. As you can see here, after a 3-year follow-up, type B dissection presented more complications than type A, operated type A. Regular clinical follow-up is necessary, more frequently within the first year after diagnosis or intervention, and then on a yearly basis. Blood pressure should be monitored closely, as more than 50% of cases may have resistant hypertension. Symptoms of chronic aortic disease are rare and non-specific. New onset hoarseness or dysphagia may develop with progressive enlargement of the aneurysm. Patients with chronic aortic dissection may report symptoms of chronic peripheral malperfusion syndrome, claudication, abdominal pain, chest or back pain may indicate progression of aortic disease. So the management of chronic aortic dissection is the control of cardiovascular risk factors, particularly arterial hypertension, to promote physical exercise, and to change the lifestyle, to use medical treatment, and the follow-up by imaging techniques, and finally endovascular or surgical treatment if aortic complications are present. For the blood pressure control, the controlling of blood pressure is one of the most important things to prevent additional problems with the aorta. Blood pressure should be lowered to 150 and 80 millimeters of mercury. Weightlifting activities should be restricted to avoid blood pressure peaks. Beta blockers have been seen to be associated with reduced aneurysmal degeneration of the dissected aorta and reduce incidence of late dissection-related aortic procedures. Angiotensin 1 blockers may be considered for antihypertensive combination treatment. Regarding physical activity, regular exercise is important for everyone. Adults should aim for at least 30 minutes per day of brisk exercise. Walking is a great way to start, with an ultimate goal of 10,000 steps per day. Mild to moderate exertion poses no problem after aortic dissection. Contact sports, very strenuous exercise, isometric exercises such as sit-ups, push-ups or pull-ups, and heavy lifting should be avoided. Straining should be avoided and exercise should not be performed to the point of exhaustion. Alterations in lifestyle and emotional state are frequent in survivors of aortic dissection. Following aortic dissection, physical inactivity increased most likely due to the fear. Functional status was mostly intact. This is unhealthy, and consistent low-intensity aerobic exercise promotes mental and physical well-being. Many patients post-dissection were unable to return to their prior occupation. Post-aortic dissection depression and anxiety are common and should be screened for and treated adequately. These findings suggest that cardiac rehabilitation will likely be beneficial in this patient's cohort. Patients also avoided sexual activity after aortic dissection. Healthcare providers should screen for and allay this unfounded fear. Clinicians should screen for unfounded fears after aortic dissection that may reduce function and or quality of life for survivors. Since aortic dissection is sometimes inherited, the first degree relatives may need to be screened to check the aorta. Depending on the family history and the etiology of the dissection, an echocardiogram and or abdominal aortic ultrasound should be performed. In specific cases, a magnetic resonance imaging or computed tomography may be recommended. After an aortic dissection with residual PET and false lumen, an imaging test assessing whole the aorta by CT, computed tomography or magnetic resonance imaging is indicated at the 3 months of discharge. To avoid exposure to radiation, magnetic resonance imaging may be more widely used in the future. Depending on that results, annual controls are advisable, at least in the first 5 years. The case shows progressive and significant enlargement of non-complicated descending aorta dissection. This asymptomatic patient presented a severe enlargement of the aorta after 3 years of follow-up and had a high risk of aortic rupture. Therefore, the patients underwent surgical treatment and evolved without complications. A close follow-up of the intramural hematoma by imaging techniques is in the first year of evolution of is crucial to determine several types of complications. The remodeling of the aorta after intramural hematoma shows different patterns. In 36% of cases, the hematoma evolved with complete regression and no dilation of the aorta. In 22% of cases, the hematoma evolved to aneurysm, fusiform aneurysm. In 8% of cases, the localized hematoma evolved to a saccular aneurysm. And finally, in 24% of cases, the hematoma presented a focal dissection with these typical images. So it's paramount to perform different imaging tests in the first 6 months. Ascending aorta complications after surgical treatment include severe aortic regurgitation, proximal or distal aorta enlargement, pseudoaneurysm, etc. And complications in descending aorta dissection or intramural hematoma imply maximal aortic diameter over 55 mm, diameter enlargement over 10 mm per year, malperfusion syndrome or recurrent pain. Thank you for your attention.